So welcome, and it's good to see so many of you back for the second day. That always makes our hearts glad. Just a few quick announcements, especially if you're new today to the conference. If you don't know this already, your wireless PIN numbers are on the back of your name tag. You will need that in order to get onto our network. There are instructions at the desk if you have any difficulty. If you have any difficulty with anything, including finding spaces in this very interesting building, look for someone with a yellow staff tag and ask them. That's why they're there. Restrooms in this building are downstairs. There should be signs, but again, if you get lost, ask someone with a yellow name tag. I have been asked to remind you to be sure to attend the wrap-up session. So we've got a panel this year. One of the feedback we've gotten over the years about this conference, which is now its fifth year, I'm happy to say, is that people wanted more time to sort of grapple with what they had been hearing and talk about it and talk about issues and respond. So that's what we are ending with this year. And it will be over in Dalton Hall, which some of you have probably already attended stuff in, because we have a room that's a bit more friendly to that kind of large group discussion. Are there any questions? Are people the most important thing, we will have coffee here in the Great Hall in the afternoon. Do not worry. So it's my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, Rebecca Floss Davis, who will be speaking today on designing for agency in the emerging digital ecosystem. Rebecca's CV is impressive. She's currently the Director of Instructional and Emerging Technology at St. Edward's University of Austin. I really like that title. She's co-director of Digital Pedagogy and Humanities. She's a prolific speaker and writer on subjects of technology and learning. She's researched network courses at liberal arts colleges and led a major digital humanities initiative. And she was working with the National Institute for the Technology for Technology in Liberal Education, that I'm not as likely. And she's helped the Association of American Colleges and Universities define best practices for general education. And she holds a PhD in classical studies from the University of Pennsylvania, so she's one of our own. But while her CV is impressive all around, I am really struck by the ways in which her work involves building connections, certainly the work that she's done with Knightley and beyond, in building connections between those of us at smaller institutions, right, and how we leverage our resources. But connection is sort of a theme running through her work in a larger sense. She's written against the isolation of digital scholarship, for example. She's a founding member of PH Commons, a hub to encourage humanities collaboration and thinking about, you know, why is there a divide between digital humanities and humanities? Things along that line. Her work transcends the university setting. Recently, she's participated in creating the strategic plan for digital inclusion for the city of Austin, which extends conversations about access, equity, connection to the whole city. And I invited her here today because I saw her speaking at the AACU conference about thinking about the digital across the curriculum, right? Across the, not sort of having it isolated onto individual projects and things like this, but how do we think about this more broadly? So without further ado, Rebecca Floss Davis. Good morning, everybody. I've come armed with my coffee. Thank you very much, Jenny, both for that great introduction and for inviting me to be here today. So, excited to be at a conference about blended learning in the liberal arts, and just in case you didn't see it on the website, I remind you that blended learning is really a broad definition, any combination of online and face-to-face instruction. I think the title of the conference really implies integration, so we're looking at blended learning in the liberal arts, and a lot of presentations I saw yesterday really wrestled with this concept. How do we reconcile the face-to-face instruction that typifies liberal arts colleges with online delivery? Today, I want to shift that question from one of delivery of education to really thinking about learning outcomes. And I also want to flip the equation a little bit. So the conference is blended learning in the liberal arts, but I want to think about liberal arts in the context of blended learning. Now, so you guys, since I work for Knightley, I would tend to use the word liberal education instead of liberal arts. Liberal arts really tends to imply small liberal arts colleges, so types of colleges, or it implies a certain set of disciplines. And I'm the term liberal education because it's broader. Liberal education happens at all kinds of colleges and universities. So the question I want to explore this morning then is, what does liberal education look like in the context of the digital? What does it look like in the emerging digital ecosystem? And how do we design liberal education for that ecosystem? If we want to answer that question, I think we actually need to start out by talking about what do we mean by digital culture? What do we mean by the emerging digital ecosystem? So I want to start with a few illustrations and a few quizzes for you guys. Just right, quizzing, that's good and blended. Okay, so here's your first quiz. If you're wearing one of these, could you hold your arm up? This is always how I find out how healthy the audience is. Can somebody explain what that is? Because I'm not wearing one. Please. There's who went to dinner with me last night, no. Because I proudly proclaimed that I reached 10,000 steps right about the time I got to dinner, and I could eat more. So, Fitbit is one of those tools we use to access our personal data, and we might use it to make decisions. I have some other tools that I use to look at data in the world around me. So, I do work in Austin. We are now number 4 in the country for gridlock. So, and I routinely have a commute that is more than an hour each way. So I spent a lot of time looking at traffic data. I was delighted to discover the Waze app, which actually crowdsources traffic data for me. So it's actually pulling data from other drivers. So you know how you get stuck in traffic and you're like, is this just volume? Is there a wreck up there? What's going on? With the Waze app, you can actually find that out. So that's another great tool. I drive a hybrid. It tells me how I'm doing while I'm driving. So I get constant up-to-the-minute data on what kind of gas mileage I'm getting. And some days, you know, if things have been going well, or actually probably usually when things have been bad, because I get better mileage when traffic is slower, right? When I get home, I get an overall score for how I did on the commute. And I feel like, I won! I won the commute today! Because my car actually gives me feedback. It says, so yeah, okay, constantly looking at data. Some of you have heard me tell that if you've talked to me, you've probably heard me say, we are now actually looking to move into Austin so that I don't have as much of a commute. And so last time I bought a house, you know how we found our house? We walked around the neighborhood where we were renting and found one for sale, and that's the one we ended up buying. But it's a completely different world. It's been probably, I guess, 11 years since we bought the last house. So now, we have a custom portal set up for us, our real estate agent, and we can get all kinds of data, and a portal filters for the search criteria that we want. So it's filtered for certain neighborhoods, certain schools. I can go in there, and I can get all the information about the house, as well as how the schools are rated, kind of statistics in the area. But I can also use other data not just in this portal. So one of the things I know about Austin is that the reason traffic is so bad is that growth has been explosive. One of the effects of that growth is that the flood maps are no longer accurate. So we've had recent floods. It's rained a lot this year. And one of the reasons the floods are so bad is that there's so much impermeable cover that the old flood maps actually need to be redrawn because water is not draining as well. So the city of Austin combined with Colorado River Authority, and you can actually go and get open data that combines flood gauge and rain totals. So I can actually go check if we're interested in a house, even though it says it's not in a floodplain, has it flooded in that area recently? And so is it going to be one that's at risk? Another interesting data point we found, we've been using Google Street View to kind of like, before we go see a house in person, let's look at the neighborhood around. Much of it is customized for us by computers and algorithms, and we use it to make decisions. So that's one aspect of digital culture that I think we need to consider. Okay, ready for your second quiz? So can anyone tell me what this is, or do you recognize where it comes from? Minecraft. So, I know this one because I have a son who's 11. His name is Roman Alexander. Jenny mentioned before, I do have a PhD in classical studies, that's how you can tell. So this is one of his creations in Minecraft. This is the library. I like to think of it as this is the place where I keep my ebooks, right? So for those of you who aren't familiar with Minecraft, I'm just take a show of hands. Who has never heard of Minecraft before? Okay, so pretty much. Okay, so for you. Minecraft is one of the most popular games in the world. Back in 2014, it actually passed 100 million registered users. So, talk about your moves. And I like to think of it as kind of like virtual Lego. So you have two modes, you can play creative mode where you make whatever you want, or you can play in survival mode where you can make whatever you want, but you also have to fight off zombies. So, I like Minecraft because of the creative potential. So I'm happy to see my son building stuff. Because he also likes Call of Duty. So I like watching the creative potential, but I'm also really fascinated by the digital culture that's grown up around Minecraft. So the kind of sharing that goes on as players share tips with each other, they mod worlds, they make worlds, and they share them, and you can download them and play them on your computer. There's sort of mashups, they sort of do custom skins, so you can kind of mash up Minecraft with anything, Harry Potter, Star Trek, Star Wars, whatever you want. So I often catch my son playing Minecraft and running into the backyard. This is him a couple years ago. And what he's doing is playing Minecraft, but he's got YouTube videos about Minecraft running. And so players will do these Let's Play videos where the devil will play on a server. He also will sit at his computer, wear our headphones, talk to a friend who's playing on the same server as they play together. So this is what you do when you're an only child. Last Thanksgiving, he decided that he actually needed his own YouTube channel, and we let him do it. Now, there are some rules, right? You can't say your name, you can't tell people where you live, you can't show your face, mom and dad get to see everything. And I'm not going to tell you his YouTube channel is because, you know, it's not that great. None of his videos have gone viral yet. And he came to me, he's like, why doesn't anyone subscribe? And I'm like, well, did you subscribe to anyone? Like, no, I haven't done that. Okay, go do that. Then it came to me, and I'm like, how do people follow me? I'm like, well, I don't know. Go watch a YouTube video, and I'll tell you how. So he did. Right, so Roman is learning about Minecraft and YouTube as part of what Henry Jenkins has termed participatory culture. In this kind of culture, you learn by participating, by doing, but you also have this kind of informal mentorship from those who are more experienced to those who are less experienced. So when Roman said he was ready to have a YouTube channel, that was really a sign that he felt like he was ready to mentor other people. And not even was free with that yet, but you know, he's out there and he's creating. So there are lots of participatory cultures out there. They're built around shared interests. So in addition to Minecraft, you can find cultures built around Nerf guns. It's another favorite of his. You can mod your Nerf gun. Then you play zombies in college campuses. They're built around surfing. So like surfing around the world is improved because people are sharing YouTube videos, and it's sort of exponentially increased what you can do in surfing culture. I'm not a surfer, so I don't know about that. We can even have a participatory culture built around blended learning. And this is where I get to pitch the hashtag for this conference on Twitter. Yes, Andy. This is a shout out to you. this was one of the top tweets last night. So if you are tweeting, my username is @CrossDavis and the hashtag for the conference is LendLAC16. Right, here's a 16 at the end. That's why he's nodding, yes. So you can kind of track and share. Even after the conference is over, you can sort of still follow this. One of the things I love about digital humanities is it really has a participatory culture. I asked someone once, how do you really learn about digital humanities? And she said, well, what I tell my graduate students is, like, here's a list of 10 people you should be following on Twitter. So
This is how learning happens in digital culture. What I've been describing is the emerging digital ecosystem. It is shaped by networks that are largely social. It is characterized by horizontal access to creation and production, and it is increasingly driven by data, algorithms, and artificial intelligence. And the synergies among these different factors form a context for learning today. So our design question is, how do we design global education for this kind of emerging digital ecosystem? At St. Edward's, we're thinking a lot about the ecosystem. We have many different teams and projects built around the ecosystem. And our take on it is we're creating a global learning ecosystem. This was a picture of what that might look like. We actually have to cross out Blackboard now because we turned that off last Friday. Yay! But the idea here is that the ecosystem that our students learn in is made up by technologies that we like to provide, but also by technologies that are just commonly available consumer-grade technologies. So you'll see WebEx on there, but you'll also see Skype. And this kind of ecosystem means that learning happens both face-to-face and online, which again is the premise of this conference, but we think also learning happens on campus and off campus, in the local community and the global community. It happens asynchronously and synchronously, and it's not a binary of either or, it's a both and, right? This is what we mean by blended learning. It's that mixture of everything into one big continuum. Just as this is the ecosystem that they're learning within, this is the ecosystem that our students are going to face when they graduate, right? This is where they're going to be pursuing their civic, social, personal, and professional lives. When I think about what the purpose of liberal education is, this is what we mean. I mean, it's to prepare you for all of that. It's to help you become a lifelong learner. So, thinking about this kind of ecosystem, I want you guys to take about 2 minutes each and turn to each other. I saw this in yesterday's keynote, right? Okay, right. I want to give you a chance to talk to each other about what kind of designs for liberal education have you seen in this ecosystem. So, talk to your friends. You guys have seen assignments that really engage with the emerging digital ecosystem, whether it's the data, the social networks. So take a couple minutes and share an assignment that you've seen that has done that, and I am going to time you. So anybody want to share an example of an assignment that they see as engaging with the emerging digital ecosystem? I'm not going to call on anybody. Anyone have a good example for us? Yes?
Thank you.
digitally informed. I think when the project started out, they really just thought, okay, maybe it'll be more equitable if we have more stuff available online, which I think is not the right answer for equity. In fact, you know, research by ACLU has shown that the kind of high impact practices that you tend to get at small liberal arts colleges are actually more beneficial to students who are more disadvantaged. So, equity-minded, digitally informed. We started thinking about this, and we started with the question of what is the role of digital in higher education? We ended up by reframing it and saying, how do we design liberal education for a digital context? If you were going to design education from scratch today, what would it look like? Keeping in mind the factors we've been discussing this morning, if we didn't have the baggage of years of tradition, what would we actually do? So we thought about that question a lot, and as we thought about the design principles, and there were two other working groups that were coming up with these. As we thought about the set of design principles that the design working group came up with, we really felt that one of the most important design principles for the emerging digital ecosystem was agency. And by agency, I mean ensuring that students are thinking actively and participating in defining, developing, and in reflecting on their personal goals for education and how it is that they're going to achieve them. It's really taking control. It's the kind of thing you need in a participatory culture. You need to sort of own and take control of your education. And I think this, when I think of that kind of work that Carol Dweck is doing on mindset theory, you know, this is having a growth mindset, meaning that you can take control and you can learn. In terms of equity, agency is very important because, you know, we have the concept of the traditional student, but in fact, the majority are non-traditional students. So people who started a community college, go on to a four-year college, and might stop out to work. And so if you want to make an integrated educational experience out of all of that, you really need agency to think about that educational experience. The work that we did on the GEMS project ties into several other projects of the Association of American Colleges and Universities. Okay, just quick poll. Who has familiar with this group? Okay, sort of.
Yay!
I mean, my people. Sometimes I do that and it's like, so AUC advocates for liberal education. In recent years, as the predominant discourse about higher education has turned increasingly to issues of vocation and career, they've engaged with that as well. And they've made the argument that, okay, if you think higher education is about career, what kind of higher education best prepares you for jobs? And in fact, it is liberal education, because liberal education prepares you not just for the job you're going to get right after graduation, but for the job you're going to get after that, and probably for the job you're going to get after that, the one that hasn't even been invented yet, right? And I've heard some statistic that said like half the jobs people will have in the future don't even exist yet. And there's certainly, I was talking on the plane with my colleague Mike about the idea that, you know, when I finished college, instructional technology wasn't really a job description. That's why I don't have a degree in instructional technology. So this is the kind of work that ASMU is doing. So if you're going to design liberal education to prepare students, essentially to be lifelong learners, how do you help them prepare for something that doesn't yet exist? Well, one of the things you do is you look at history. You look at trends and try to guess where things are going. So there's a couple of labor economists who have done this in a piece called Dancing with Robots, Levy and Renee, track five tasks that typify the labor economy. So based on these, and they track these over 30 years. Now looking at the trends, what you'll see, those top two trend lines are working with new information and solving unscripted problems. And those are the things that are trending up. There's another line trending up. It's kind of actually sort of at the bottom and then it goes back up. That's non-routine manual tasks. I think that's the service industry. So the idea is, going into the future, you know, this is the effects of automation and outsourcing. The jobs that are really going to stay around are the things that you need humans to do. It's dealing with new information and solving unstructured problems. But they call their work Dancing with Robots because they also argue that even these things are going to happen with the assistance of technology. So thinking even like non-routine manual tasks. Think of a surgeon, right? This is someone who works with their hand, surgeon comes from the Greek word for hand. So they are doing manual labor. But today, they generally often are doing it using robots or sort of using tiny instruments controlled by technology to actually do surgery. So in the future, these are the tasks that we're preparing our students for. Our graduates need the ability to deal with new information, solve unstructured problems, and partner with technology to do that. The same skills and abilities that are going to prepare them for these kinds of jobs will also serve them well in to solve unstructured problems in their civic, cultural, social, personal lives. So when AAC says, yes, liberal education.